So this will be a kind of introduction to Edmund Husserl. And Husserl, how many of you have read anything by Husserl so far? Oh, you? Yeah. Oh, you too? Yeah. Because he's not one of the most widely read philosophers, although he might have been one of the most influential philosophers, if you count references and so on. And that's because he is really the main background figure for what is called continental philosophy. And we'll go a little bit into his influence in that way. And one reason that he's not so widely read is that his own writings are extremely badly written. He was not a good communicator. And when I first discovered Husserl, I thought this can't possibly be good philosophy, because normally if a person is able to think clearly, he should also be able to express his thoughts clearly. So it's always a bad sign if somebody doesn't write very clearly. The problem with Husserl is not that it's not so clear, but it's so complicated and long-winded. And once I sat down with him, I don't usually turn completely off after just half a page. I do want to look a little longer at the person before I decide against. And I discovered that there was a lot of precision and structure to it. And it was mostly his German. It was very complicated and sometimes even ungrammatical. He starts in a sentence that goes through half a page, and then sometimes you see that there's a lack of grammar. And in any case, it takes some time to work your way through all these long, long sentences. And that's reflected in the German, in the English translations of Husserl. First, they were slow in coming. These works are important work, as we'll see, started coming in around 1900 by Husserl. And the first English translation was in 1934. That was of the ideas, this book here, which I consider his main work. And that work was easy to read. And when I started teaching Husserl, that was in 61, then there was no choice. That was the book to read. I taught at Stanford, and I taught at Harvard at that time. And of course, most of the students couldn't read German, so they had to read English, and there was no choice. That was the only text available. And I always tell students, and I tell you, that if there is anything in the reading that you find it hard to understand, please come to my office hours. I don't have office hours here, but at least I had a stream of students coming to my office hours with this book. And they said that here, Husserl says exactly the opposite of what you said in the lectures. And I had to look at the text. I had not read through the English. I just thought it was an okay translation. And then it discovered that the person, his name Gibson, important work in psychology. And we can see later why Husserl was relevant to his work. But in any case, Gibson had probably done the translating late in the evening when he was too tired to do anything else. And you can see how he has started on one line, and then his eyes dropped to the next, and he continued there. And there might have been a knot or something on that part that was dropped. So very often the text in the translation actually says the opposite of what it said in the original. Because a knot may be quite a big difference. And so I had to gradually work out a list of all the errors in that translation, but there was no choice. And then, finally, I think about 19, or maybe around year 2000, there was a new translation coming out, published by Niehoff, later Springer. Kersten was the translator. It's called the Kersten translation. That was the second translation of this book. And I, of course, told the students then on to read that translation. And then in America, students evaluate the course. You get the evaluation and feedback at the end of the term from all the students. And almost half the students complained that there was too much reading for that course. It took them too long to read compared to normal courses. And it's the same book. I never got that complaint when I read Gibson. But they started complaining when they read Kersten. And the reason was that Kersten keeps almost literally the German original. You have that heavy German syntax in English, which makes the English almost as hard to read as the German. So that is not a good translation either. And in fact, I mentioned on the handout that you got the announcement that is a translation now out, came out last year, which is good. It's readable and fairly accurate. And it's inexpensive because it's published by Hackett. It specializes on bringing out classics in inexpensive terms. So, and if you then should get the translation of the ideas, of course, how many of you would be able to read it in German? Yeah. So then it's, yeah, that's right, but in English, how many? Then one little thing you should note, I wrote it down here, is that this person was such a bad expositor. That if you, as you normally would, start at the first page, it will take you very long before you understand at all what is going on. So my advice is to start on section 27. Then you get a fairly straightforward introduction to the topic. And then when you've been through the book from there, then you go back and read the first 26 sections. Then they make good sense. But he had a great problem putting himself in the reader's place and giving a presentation that starts from where the reader is. He is a kind of very systematic thinker who starts where it, from a systematic point of view, might be natural, but there's no way in which he leads the reader into that way of looking at things. So that was something about the reading, and now since everybody's here, did everybody get a list of lectures? Yeah. So then we'll start. So with the times, I'll lecture here on Mondays from 10:15 onwards before Øystein's lectures. And this is the plan that we got. So today I'll talk about Husserl's life and work and this key topic in Husserl, intentionality. And in connection, to make that more precise, we'll go into these technical terms, Manuisis, Hele, and perception. And then next time, I'll talk about what he calls eidos, or essence, in English. And there, the phenomenological reduction that you often heard about, certainly, which consists of two other reductions. I go through that and also talk about the transcendental ego. And then, third time, after that we get into the topic that I mentioned, which is a very important topic of in Husserl. It's really the idea of intersubjectivity, how we are living in a world that we are sharing, and we are, exactly, if you're blind, you'll not say, I live in a world that is not visible. The world is visible, but unfortunately I cannot see it, but others can see it, and we do come to adjust our conception of the world because we are living together with others. So we go from subjectivity via intersubjectivity to the notion of objectivity. And all the time I'm going to relate what we say to other philosophers. Very often people, I think you might know, Donald Davidson, how many have been reading anything by him? He actually spent a whole semester here as a visitor once. And one collection of his essays is called Subjectivity, Intersubjectivity, Objectivity, and that could have been taken from Husserl, and the way of thinking about it is a little bit similar. And then connected with that you also have the notion of empathy, which is very important in Husserl and which for him is the basis for ethics. So we'll go into Husserl's ethics and also his notion of normativity, what should be the norm is not a matter of counting votes, but it's a matter of having the right kind of perspective. So there could be a decision which is made, which is objective, because it's made by people who are very well acquainted with the matters. And you wouldn't get that kind of a decision if you just counted votes. For those who know Hilary Putnam's work, he mentions in one place that he's not such a good expert on trees, so when he's out in the forest, he cannot see the difference between elms and beeches. But he thinks there is a difference. And in order to find out what it is, you go to those who have really studied it, to the botanist. And then they can tell you, this is an elm and this is a beech. So that's exactly the kind of emphasizing qualified insight when you want to come to that kind of decision. And actually the same in ethics for Husserl. You don't decide what is right and wrong by vote, but you do it by arguments and so on. I think we philosophers are familiar with appealing to arguments, and Husserl is very good at explaining what is the difference between good and bad arguments in ethics. And then the 23rd will be Husserl's philosophy of mathematics. How many of you are following Øystein's course? So the others are not. So I will. This discussion will be relevant to Øystein's course, but I'll try to make it in such a way that you see how the whole foundations of mathematics really flows very naturally out of Husserl's approach to philosophy. It's connected with this notion of eidetic reduction and so on that we'll get to. So that it will be no problem for those of you who have not dealt with logic and mathematics beforehand to understand what Husserl thinks about the foundations of mathematics. And among these philosophers who were mathematicians, who were strongly influenced by Husserl, I'll go into Gödel and Hermann Weyl. Gödel, all of you have heard of. And Gödel actually was so impressed by Husserl that when he discovered Husserl, that was in 1969, then he said that Husserl really has had the kind of insights that he had been striving for. Gödel, long before he read Husserl, had views on the foundations of mathematics which were very similar to Husserl's. He had not gotten from Husserl, but they were similar. And then when he discovered Husserl, he saw that here all of these glimpses that he had were really worked out in a very systematic and comprehensive framework of looking at the foundations of mathematics. So he was very impressed, and Gödel actually got hold of everything that was available by Husserl at that time. And in the Gödel archives in Princeton, you can see how he read these books by Husserl that was available and put comments in the margin. And those comments are, in my view, some of the best comments anybody has written on Husserl. So once Gödel discovered Husserl, he did a better job in really understanding him properly than many of the professional philosophers who have been working for decades on Husserl. So I think that that testifies that Gödel was really quite a philosopher, but also that Husserl was, because Gödel found that Husserl had been even more clear and systematic than he had been himself. So from then on, he really stuck to Husserl. And if you want to read comments on Husserl, these comments on Gödel would be excellent. They are not quite out, but I hope they will be coming out. Some of them have been included in Gödel's collected works. And another person, how many of you have heard of Hermann Weyl? You have heard, because you are in physics.
No, because you mentioned him.
Because I mentioned
him.
Oh, yeah, that's right. So Hermann Weyl was a very important mathematician. He was one of the last mathematicians who really covered the whole ground in mathematics. John von Neumann is another one. Hilbert was the third one. But now it's almost impossible for anybody who know all the branches of mathematics enough to contribute to them. And Hermann Weyl was one of them. And he was married to somebody who studied with Husserl. So there for a while, went with his wife and listened to Husserl, and was also quite impressed by Husserl's thinking. This was in Göttingen, and Weil was in Göttingen partly because of Hilbert, and Hilbert was the one who had got Husserl to come to Göttingen, because Hilbert wanted somebody to do philosophy there. He also knew math, and Husserl, as we shall see, already had a PhD, good PhD in mathematics. And so Weil came to Husserl's lecture and was also very impressed, although I think the lectures, like his books, were a little hard to follow, because Husserl didn't lecture freely, but he read from the manuscripts, and that only told you how complicated those manuscripts are to read, and they must have been even more complicated to listen to. But still, he had these people coming, and Hermann Weil was one of them. And there was Hilbert wanted Weil to be his successor in Göttingen. Göttingen was at that time the main center in the world for mathematics. And Weil wanted to take over, but then you got the Nazi period, and Weil decided to emigrate. Weil was not himself a Jew, but his wife was a Jew, so it wouldn't be tenable for them to stay on. So he then became professor at the Center for Advanced Study in Princeton, and contributed greatly both to mathematics and to the development of the theory of relativity. And there's a good deal of correspondence in the late 20s after Weil had left, and between Weil and Husserl, where Weil discusses with Husserl some of the ideas he has about how to understand relativity theory and so on. And Husserl writes back that, and he's honest, he says that he has not followed the field of mathematics enough to really take a stand on what Weil is writing. But Weil keeps on explaining very well his ideas to Husserl. And he was clearly very happy with the few comments that Husserl could make on it. But it was really too technical for Husserl, who had not done technical mathematics since he left mathematics. So, and then the last day, you'll take up topics of your choice, and you can do that. Just tell me when we go on whether there's something you want to hear more about, or something that is unclear, so that I'll try to fit it in, so that as long as we can keep this rough schedule, we can put in a lot of things that you might be particularly interested in on the way. So then we'll go on to Husserl himself. And in connection with Husserl, there are some few people whom you might know from other sources and who have a good deal of connection with Husserl. First, there's Franz Brentano, who was an Austrian philosopher, and who was among philosophers clearly the one who influenced Husserl the most. Husserl actually studied with Brentano, and I'll show you going to later how that happened, how he got to know about Brentano and how it happened. But one way in which he got to know about Brentano is that Husserl was himself from Moravia, present Czechia, and he has a very close friend of Thomas Masaryk. Do you know him? How many of you have heard of Thomas Masaryk? He was, but in any case, Masaryk was the president, the founder, and the first president of the Czech Republic. And he was also a philosopher. And Husserl was coming from the same part of Czechia to study in Vienna. And Masaryk brought Husserl with him to listen to the lectures of Brentano. But at that time, Husserl was set on doing mathematics. He was very impressed by Brentano and his lectures, but he then went on to Berlin to study mathematics. We'll look more at that later. Another interesting thing is that Freud was a fellow student of Husserl with Brentano. Brentano had lots of very good and important and influential students. In addition to Husserl, he had Freud. And Freud was 3 years older than Husserl. Husserl was born in 1859. But he also went to these lectures by Brentano, and there's a good deal in Freud's views on the importance of the unconscious, subconscious and so on, that stems from Brentano, and that is similar to ideas that we'll encounter in Husserl. I should maybe mention, since I mentioned Freud now, that Brentano was a little at odds with most of the philosophers in the German-speaking world at that time, because he was skeptical to German idealism. And he advised his own students to read the British philosophers like Hume, British empiricists and so on, rather than reading the German idealists. We'll get back to that when we compare Husserl and Kant. But at least through Brentano, Husserl actually had a slightly negative attitude to the German idealists, including Kant. But we'll see how that developed. And Brentano was particularly impressed by John Stuart Mill, who was at that time still alive. And he wanted John Stuart Mill's Logic, which is not simply a logic book, but is more a kind of general philosophy of science book. I wanted that to be translated into German. And he noticed that among his students there was one who wrote very well, and that was Freud. So he asked Freud to translate Mill's Logic into German, and Freud did. So Freud was the translator of Mill. Then there was an early philosopher who is my favorite philosopher, Bernard Bolzano, who, as you saw, lived quite early. He died just the year Frege was born, and was very similar to Frege in many ways. And he was a priest in Bohemia, in Czechia, and was remarkable for the breadth, wildness of what he did. He was, like Husserl, made very important contributions to the foundations of mathematics. He wrote on theology, he wrote on ethics, and he wrote on social issues. He was, Bolzano, he was in charge of the lectures that were given every Sunday in this church of the university where he was teaching. Being a Catholic priest, that was a natural thing for him to give the Sunday sermon. But those sermons were concentrated very much on social and ethical issues. And those sermons are now available in print. They're called Erbauungsreden, also sermons that should build up something in the students. And there he discusses, for example, private property right. He said that land should not belong to big landowners who lived in the city and had other people working for them at a starving salary, but they should belong to those who till the earth. And he had views on equality of men and women. He argued that women should have exactly the same rights as men to be candidates, to vote at elections and so on. It took a long, long time before that came. John Stuart Mill repeated the same thing later, but Bolzano was so early in these views. He's, as far as I can see, he must have been the earliest one who really gave a very, very good case for equality between men and women in all fields, also political. And the students flocked to his lectures. He was not like Husserl, who read his complicated manuscripts, but he was able to communicate very well with the students. And this was in Austria-Hungary, which at that time was very oppressive. And Metternich was pretty much in charge, and it was unbearable for Metternich to have that priest going there and drawing all these hundreds of students into the church and telling them these wild things. So Bolzano was simply brought to court and jailed to life in prison. At that time he was around 30, so it would be a long, long prison life. Fortunately, he had some good friends who had an estate out in the country, and they proposed to the government that, why don't you save money? We can keep him in our estate. We'll make sure he doesn't flee. And you save money by not having him in jail. And they admitted that. He was not permitted to publish or lecture anything anymore. But in a way it's good for us because he sat there writing. And there's so many interesting writings by him. He was the first one to really see problems of analytic, synthetic, and lots of the issues that concern philosophers nowadays. And I think it's symptomatic that a Swedish philosopher, Anders Wedberg, who I think was a very important figure in philosophy in Nordic countries, one of the early people, Anders Wedberg, and after him, Frank von Richt, Georg Henrik von Richt, that these are very important early philosophers in Scandinavia, who were important for the fact that people got to learn about these more rigid philosophers, these more precise philosophers. And Wedberg wrote a history of philosophy in the world in 3 volumes, which is out at Cambridge University Press. And the first volume is called, the third volume is called Philosophy in the 20th Century. And whom you guess is the first chapter is devoted to the first philosopher of the 20th century, and that's Bolzano, born 1781. So that is remarkable. Then you get to all the later ones who are generally active after 1900. But Wedberg was so impressed by Bolzano that that's what happened. So Bolzano is one I should have liked to relate. I have given courses on Bolzano. But when I first started lecturing on Husserl and wanted to bring in Bolzano, I discovered that there was not a word available by Bolzano in English. He was not even mentioned in Encyclopedia Britannica. So I had to get some things translated into English. And that time I felt it would be good to have somebody who was really good at English to translate it. And I had a student in my course who I thought was a very good writer and who also knew German. So I asked him to translate a selection from Bolzano. And he did, and these are very good translations, but he unfortunately left philosophy and became a filmmaker. And you may know him, his name is Terry Malik. And he has won lots of Oscars and Berlin Bear and so on, because he was really very good. And he kept his interest in philosophy in his films. You can see much of this, especially these things we're getting to in Husserl, because he specialized on Husserl when he worked with me. And this thing about having different perspectives on what happens, that's a very good technique often in films, that you go between different perspectives and what happens changes its character very much when you see it from different perspectives. But in any case, he was the first one then to translate things by Bolzano. Then you have Frege, who was born in 1859, so Frege was 11 years older, and they had contact. Frege, you know, Frege was not being much read. His main work he had to pay for himself to get published, and when it came out, Grundgesetze, then he complains that apparently it fell deadborn from the press. Nobody seemed to read it. But Husserl actually read it, and in the Husserl archives in Leuven, you have Husserl's copies of Frege's work, and they are very carefully marked. Yes. Even in the technical proofs in the Grundgesetze, Husserl has discovered a couple of small misprints, so he has read the proper proofs in addition to just reading the text. But there's a good deal of interesting similarity between Husserl and Frege, and the presentation, the interpretation I'll give of Husserl now in the course, this is my, that's the interpretation I think is right, brings out some parallels between Husserl and Frege. So sometimes it's called the Fregian reading of Husserl. Very often it's called the analytic reading of Husserl, because while traditionally the study of Husserl has been regarded as just continental philosophy, which is not, has nothing to do with analytic philosophy, this is the division people often find in contemporary philosophy between on the one side the continental and on the other the analytic. And the way I interpret Husserl, he belongs on both sides. I don't think there are these sides at all. In any case, for that reason, this interpretation is called also the analytic reading of Husserl. But we'll see, because you know, I spent more time on Husserl than anybody else, reading for years these manuscripts. And there are so many important passages in the manuscript that fit in with this way of reading him and do not fit in with the other ways of reading him. I think that it's an advantage, actually, when you want to read Husserl, to have a very good background in so-called analytic philosophy, because then you are very familiar with the concerns that drove Husserl and with the distinctions and so on that he made in order to deal with these concerns. Then another person who was connected with Husserl was Heidegger, who was Husserl's assistant for some years, and who took over Husserl's professorship in Freiburg when Husserl retired, and who is regarded by many as Husserl's main student. But Heidegger very quickly started to emphasize differences between himself and Husserl. I'll see what we get time for, but in any case, Heidegger's first main work, Being and Time, was dedicated to Husserl. And there is, if you look at Heidegger, a kind of unfortunate feature that you find a lot of in German philosophy. And that is that Germany was organized in such a way that there would be different institutes for different subjects, institute for philosophy, and at the head of each institute there will be a head professor. And he decided about fellowships, about appointments and so on. And if you wanted to get a job, you just had to agree with him, or at least not criticize him. And Heidegger was Husserl's assistant and wanted to succeed him. And he did his best to make Husserl feel that he was really a good successor. He shared Husserl's views and so on, and Husserl was very happy with Heidegger, regarded him as his best student. And actually in the Heidegger's writings up to 1927, there's a lot of emphasis on the similarities with Husserl. But then Husserl retired, and being the old professor, he had lots of say in who was going to be his successor, so he wanted Heidegger to be a successor. And Heidegger succeeded him in Freiburg. And then, immediately afterwards, Heidegger started to emphasize the differences between him and Husserl. He says that what I do is not phenomenology, it's uses different words for it, but emphasizes Sein, being, study of being. And Husserl discovered this. When he read Sein und Zeit, he put in the margin on his copy, which is in Löwen, which I've been reading. There he has comments in the margin, and then he said in some places that Heidegger says here is exactly what I said there, but it's translated into another terminology, and then he gives a correlation between the terms. And if you put the terms into the Heideggerian sentences, you get sentences that could be taken straight out of Husserl. So here he says it's all a matter of translation and gives really the translation key. But then he gets more and more irritated when he goes on in Sein und Zeit, and he says that it's translating into a deep-sounding terminology. Angst, Sein, and so on. He thinks that people there felt must be important in human life and very important philosophically. So that, again, it's translation. But then Husserl says, further, gets more and more irritated as he gets on. He says, for example, in one passage here, Heidegger has really struggled very hard in order to avoid using the word intentionality, because that, as we will see, is a key passage in Husserl, key word. As soon as people saw the word intentionality, they would think of Husserl. And if one goes back into the drafts of Being and Time, the book by Heidegger, one sees that he actually uses the word intentionality, but then he probably saw that if he used the word intentionality, people immediately associate with Husserl, and then he put in some other word instead. And it also says in many places that this is just my view, that robbed of every justification. He felt that the arguments he had been giving for his view, telling why we should accept it and what the problems were and how we should get around the problems, and all arguments were gone. So if you sum it up, he would simply look upon Sein und Zeit as a translation of his own phenomenology into a deep-sounding terminology and robbed of every justification. So that this is, of course, very sharp, but he was very, very disappointed with Heidegger when he saw how he developed after he got the job. And another thing that happened was that Husserl was a Jew. When he retired, shortly afterwards, Hitler took power. Heidegger immediately sided with Hitler. He even wrote pamphlets urging people to vote for Hitler. And when Hitler got power, he made Heidegger rector of the University of Freiburg. And one of his tasks as a rector was to take care of the book burning, so that Jewish books by Jewish authors were burned in front of the university. He didn't really take the initiative. But he, I've been reading a lot of, I've been lecturing on Heidegger's philosophy, whole semester courses, and I think there are some interesting things, because if you look at it from the Husserlian perspective, you can see that most of it is just translation from Husserl, but there are some points where he says something that you don't find in Husserl, especially having to do with practical activity and the way in which practical activity contributes to shaping our world. But he also has this clear Nazi things in his writings, and it seems to me that more than being a just straight Nazi, he was one who was opportunistic. He changed his views according to what might first bring him his professorship and then after bring him to political power. And it was quite clear that Heidegger hoped that Hitler would make him the head ideologist of the Nazi party. However, there was another competitor, and that competitor did something to Heidegger which was remarkable. He quoted passages from Sein und Zeit, where you have these very deep-sounding discussions of something. And in this place, Heidegger discusses the directional signals of cars. You know, at that time, cars had a thing that went up when he wanted to turn to this side or that side, and he describes over one full page the phenomenology of directional signals. He doesn't use phenomenology, but it's the kind of ontology of directional signals. And then one of the other Nazi philosophers writes an article on this called Heidegger. The title of it is Heidegger and the Destruction of the German Language. And then he quotes these passages, which especially out of context seem completely wild. And then he says, and this kind of philosopher, you would like to be party philosopher. And that really ended it, because of course people hadn't read Heidegger at all, but those passages that he quoted indicate to everybody that he can't be a good party philosopher. So Heidegger had to give up that side. But we are not going to point to Heidegger, but there is this close relationship between Heidegger and Husserl. And of course Heidegger then was taking care of the book burning, and also there is a good deal of bad episodes between Heidegger and Husserl later. Mostly that Husserl didn't want anything to do with Heidegger. They were there in the same little town, Freiburg, and Heidegger tried to show that he was friendly to Husserl in spite of his being a Jew and so on, but it didn't really help much. So then another person who we should look at, maybe we should not look at him, but if you had lots of time we would look at him, is Gadamer, who is often regarded as the founder of new hermeneutics and who was a student of Heidegger's. And he gives a lot of credit to Heidegger for the basic ideas of the new hermeneutics. And he didn't seem to have studied much Husserl, but Husserl's philosophy is excellently suited for exactly being the basis for the new hermeneutics. We shall see that if we get a little bit of time. So that hermeneutics, the theory of interpreting, texts and other things that can be interpreted. That's very closely connected with Husserl's idea of intentionality and constitution and so on. How what we experience is very much shaped by our previous views, our previous background, our previous experience, and that is a big topic in Gadamer. Gadamer calls it in German "Vorurteile." In Norwegian, it's easy to translate "fordommer." In English, it's a little harder: prejudgments, something like that. The unfortunate thing is that he calls it judgment, because you have the same idea in Husserl, but Husserl says that this is not something that we normally are aware of. Most of the important things in interpretation are attitudes or views that we have and that have seeped into us from our culture and that we're not aware of. So that's one big difference in the Husserlian approach. These are mostly things we're not aware of, and they are very important. In Gadamer, it's prejudgments, and the word judgment immediately indicate that it's something we are conscious of. But apart from that, the whole idea of interpretation has a very fine basis in Husserl, as you shall see. Then there's Sartre. And if you read some of the biographies of Sartre, you'll see that he went to Freiburg to study with Husserl. But not quite right, because Sartre came to Germany to study phenomenology. He did it actually on the advice of Raymond Aron. How many of you heard of Raymond Aron? Yeah. Raymond Aron was Jon Elster's thesis advisor in France, and he was very impressed by phenomenology. And he advised Sartre, who was a couple of years younger than him, and they were very good friends throughout their lives, advised Sartre to go to Germany to study phenomenology. And he did. But this was in late as 32, and at that time Husserl had retired. And this is a story which is funny, but I checked it, and unfortunately it's not true. But the story is that Heidegger referred to Sartre as that young Frenchman who always calls me Husserl. Because Sartre went to Heidegger's lectures and apparently thought he was listening to Husserl, and he learned about phenomenology in that way. But in any case, there is no direct connection then between Sartre and Husserl, that Sartre was very interested in phenomenology. And we can see, and I've actually written a good deal on, how Sartre's work can be read from a Husserlian perspective, and then it starts making a lot of sense. And especially his literary work, a lot of novels and plays by Sartre get particularly interesting when we look at the background in phenomenology. And then we have Merleau-Ponty, who also is very much influenced by Husserl, and in that case the influence is direct. He was not working with Heidegger, but he got access to Husserl's manuscripts in Leuven, and Husserl's manuscript had been brought to Leuven by a Franciscan monk in 1938, when Husserl died. He got all of Husserl's library manuscripts out of Freiburg, where they would have been destroyed, and into Belgium, where they were kept during the war in an archive. And Merleau-Ponty was given access to those manuscripts in 1939. And he is very clear, while Heidegger tried to hide his background in Husserl, Merleau-Ponty again and again thanks Husserl for insights, and he's very grateful for having had access to these manuscripts in Leuven. And among the manuscripts that he appreciated the most are the second and third volume of this. You see, Husserl was planning this as a three-volume work, but only one volume came out. The others were left unfinished. But the manuscript for the second and third volume, which deal very much with the notion with our body, the role of our body, the role of human activity and so on in our experience of the world, that's a very important topic in Merleau-Ponty. And I would recommend Merleau-Ponty as a good person to read if you want to explore further that aspect of Husserl. There's a lot of it still available in manuscripts, and the two last volumes of this are out in both English and German, so you can read some there, but they are a little bit fragmentary because Husserl hadn't really completed the text for them. So these are some people then connected with Husserl, and now I want to say a little bit about his life and work. He was born in 1859 in Prosnitz, Moravia, the present Czech Republic. And then, you see, when he was 17, he started studying, first in Leipzig, and he wanted actually to study astronomy, but he was soon discovered that he needed to know a lot of mathematics in order to do astronomy properly, so he gradually changed to mathematics. And he also did that a little bit in Vienna, but only a little. That's when Masaryk brought him to the lectures of Brentano, because Brentano was lecturing on philosophy in Vienna. But this didn't stay long there, but went on to Berlin. And the reason that he went to Berlin was that that was the center for mathematics at that time. I said that later on, when Husserl came to Göttingen, many, many years later, 50 years later, then Göttingen was the world center, but at that time Berlin was the world center. And there they had three mathematicians who were really top. And one of them was Weierstrass. He became Husserl's advisor for his PhD, and he was probably the most prominent mathematician in the world at that time, and also focused a lot on conceptual clarity and so on, that were impressing Husserl. Kronecker was also a very good mathematician, very interested in philosophy of mathematics, and Kronecker is particularly known in the philosophy of mathematics too, because he had a kind of semi-Platonic view. He thought that the integers exist, but not like everything else in mathematics is made by humans. So that's his view. The integers, the existing entities on a par with trees and houses and everything else, but everything else in mathematics is man-made. So at least you might not agree, but he was really very interested and engaged in philosophical topics, as was Weierstrass. And then there was Kummer, who was not quite as well known as the others, but and I won't see much about him, but these are the three people who taught him. And then he got his doctorate in 1882, and it's on calculus of variation, that is a branch of mathematics. But here we have a problem, the duck-rabbit picture. Because sometimes some people would see a duck, others see a rabbit, and you yourself could jump back and forth between seeing a duck and a rabbit. But how can it be that you see it sometimes as a duck and sometimes as a rabbit, if it's a matter of reception? Well, Husserl discusses this, starting actually in the 90s. This picture, by the way, the duck-rabbit picture, you don't find that in Husserl. You find it in Wittgenstein in 1924, and he refers to a Gestalt psychologist, Jastrow, for that picture. It's one of the very few times that Wittgenstein ever mentions where he got something from. This picture got from Jastrow. But Jastrow, in 1924, got it from early people. It was a picture very much used in the whole Gestalt psychological tradition, and it illustrates how we give shape to what we experience. And the picture was used in a humor magazine in 1892, so that's quite early. But at that time, people started to become interested in this sort of phenomenon. And Wittgenstein lived up in Vienna at the time when there were very much discussion of these phenomenological ideas that we are now going to look at. So he sees that it's perception is something, to see something as something. And this could be taken to be a way of reading Husserl. that Husserl saw a point that Wittgenstein did not see, although Husserl saw it long earlier. Because what is that first ethnos? That there's something that is seen as something. What is it? The problem is that Wittgenstein uses pictures. And the Gestalt psychologist uses pictures. So they based perception on the fact that when you see a picture, you could see different things in that picture. So you see this object, the picture, as one thing or as another. For Husserl, as we shall see, there is no object in that sense up there. All that happens in perception is that our sensory organs are being irritated and the structuring comes from there. So there's no... Many people have talked about there being sense data, and then they interpret them in different ways. So the idea is often that there is something there that is interpreted in different ways, and that is where Husserl had a different kind of insight. And now we'll see what this insight was. First, he uses the word horizon, the same German word. And that is that we are, when we are encountering the world around us, we always have already a great background of past experience. And that past experience colors, structures, contributes to structuring what we experience. And these, we could call them beliefs that we have of some kind. Sometimes desires come in also because there are normative things coming into the picture. And first we have those that we have verbalized, talked about. And then we have also other beliefs and desires that one has been aware of. And when somebody asks you and reminds you, then you could say, oh yeah, that's right, I could mention that too. So we approach all our experience in that way. But we also could have beliefs and desires that one has never been aware of, never thought about it. That's very much of what we call culture, are really beliefs and desires that we have never thought about. They just seep in. So I think seeping in is a good word. And but often you can verbally express them. When we are becoming aware of it, we could say, oh yes, I certainly thought so and so. But then there would be dispositions, both bodily and mental, that cannot be verbally expressed. So we have these four levels of things that we bring to our experience. We could call it anticipations, but even the word anticipation is misleading, because what you anticipate is something that we are not normally aware of, and when we are made aware of it, we say, oh, that's it, I thought of that kind of thing. So that this is just an attempt by me to sort out four levels of anticipations, things we bring with us. And the third and the fourth level are really found a little bit before Husserl in William James' book on psychology that came in 1894. And Husserl read that book. And in that book, William James calls these fringes. And I think it's a very good book to read. I think James was an excellent author, communicates extremely well, finds very good examples. And he talks about this phenomenon that is important in James called fringes, which are these hidden assumptions that we make, hidden anticipations that we have. And Husserl read that book just shortly after Frege's review, when Husserl decided not to continue with philosophy or arithmetic and wanted to develop a different kind of approach to these issues. Then he read William James' Psychology. And then he said, I think James has done what should be done in philosophy. I'll go back to mathematics. But he decided there may be something more. and what James had done. Not that he disagreed with him, but he thought, well, there's more to be said about these things. So that's why he... But it's always, if you're very interested in comparisons, then James and Husserl are very good philosophers to compare. And by the way, I've had joint seminars every time when I've been at Stanford. Every year I've had seminars together with a colleague. And Pat Suppes has been a specialist on James. And we have had seminars on James and Husserl, where he brought in what he knew about James and I what I knew about Husserl. And then we compared and contrasted. So what did one have that the other one didn't, and so on. And now the notion of intentionality in Husserl is this idea that when we experience something, there's so much more going on. It's not simply passive reception, as we saw in Aristotle, but we are actually structuring. And that was called intentionality. And gestalt theory in psychology is very much a study of this structuring that we perform, but it came a good deal later. The main gestalt psychologists are from 1911, 1912, and on, and very many of them made use of Husserl's work on this in their own psychology. And in order to get a grasp on this intentionality, I'm going to talk about the noema, about anticipations, how the object transcends our experience of it, as opposed to Wittgenstein seeing something as so on. Prejudgments, that's Gadamer, and past, present, future, and value. So these are the topics that are connected with intentionality and that we will now go into. And a further point that is important here that we'll get into is that our experience is direct. That is, Husserl does not think that we first, in perception, get a real sense data, and then we take a kind of constructive step and think of these as being connected with objects. Our experience from the very beginning, and early beginning, and Husserl discusses that quite a lot, how does the notion of object arise in our experience? But we are experiencing objects. When I see another human being, I see a person. I don't see a collection of sense data and then give structure to it. I see directly a person. And when that person is moving, I don't see movements and then perform an inference to think that there are actions going on. So Descartes, for example, who looked out his window and saw these moving bodies and thought it was a big problem to go from moving bodies to persons, he does not have this kind of Husserlian approach to it. So that these are not bodies, but they are persons, so that we are actually in our experience experiencing objects, physical objects around us, actions, people, and persons directly. There's no in between. There's not something we first observe and then we have a kind of inference to perform to go from that to the object. We don't go first sense data and then objects. And this has consequences for behaviorism. The one philosopher who brought me into philosophy was Quine. Even after I'd read Husserl, I couldn't dream of going into philosophy. I wanted to stay in mathematics and physics. But then I read Quine, and then I thought, that's the way of doing philosophy. Then I couldn't imagine beforehand how we could have it as a profession. But then I read him. But of course, Quine is known for his behaviorism, like Skinner and others. And there is something in behaviorism which doesn't really seem very satisfactory, because you start out with behavior, observe behavior. Quine emphasizes that you have to have empirical evidence for what you say. We don't communicate through telepathy, but we have to. Communication is based on our living together with others, and it makes use of the senses. I hear what somebody says, I see what movements that person is making. So therefore, Quine says, the basis has to be of communication has to be observation of sounds coming out of the person's mouth, of the person looking like that and so on, doing this kind of movements. And that's typical of behaviorism. And Skinner, who was a close friend of Quine's, he made that his basis of his psychology. He was professor of psychology at Harvard. And Quine takes over that label, although his behaviorism is much more sophisticated than Skinner. So when Chomsky criticized behaviorism, he picked Skinner as his opponent and not Quine, because Skinner was relatively easy to criticize, but Quine's view was much more subtle. And of course he did the opposite of what Frege did. Frege said that if I want to criticize psychologism, I should take it at its best, and that's Husserl. Skinner said, if I want to criticize behaviorism, I should take it as its weakest, and that would be somebody like Skinner or some other psychologist. But if you look at his arguments, they don't really fit very well against Quine. But in any case, if you look at Husserl and then look at Quine, you notice that there is something important that Husserl saw but Quine did not see. And I discussed this a lot with Quine, and he gradually changed his view. And there is an interview with Quine in an Italian journal in 1996, where Quine says that I have discovered that my view seems to be very similar to that of Husserl. So then he had changed completely in view of seeing how Husserl dealt with some of these issues that he had been dealing with. And I wrote an article a couple of years ago, which I could give to you, which is a relatively long discussion of Quine and his behaviorism. And it's called The Development of Quine's Behaviorism. And the development is very much due to starting to look at things the way Husserl did. So if you want to, I could certainly find that article. So when having a Husserl's view of perception, when we perceive a tree, let us say, we are anticipating features of that object. We anticipate that it has another side. You know, when I see a tree out there, I'm not really... I would be very astonished if I went and didn't find another side, if it was just a stage prop or something like that. There would be what Husserl calls an explosion of my view. That is, something radical happened, and I said, this is not a tree at all, it's a stage prop. So, and that has to do with the other side, but also with the past, the present, and the future. We'll come back to that again more, but I experience something that has a past, it's presently here, and it has a future. If I see a big tree outside my window, and there was no tree there at all the day before, then that's something to worry about. And then you expect that if you go out, you must find that the tree has been planted there just recently or something like that. Or if you see it today and look out the window, it's gone. Then again, you go out and try to find traces. Expect a tree to last, especially a big tree like that, should have a past and a future. And it would also have various evaluative features. It could be good for something. It could be practically applicable and so on. And what happens in perception is then that when I perceive a tree, I could structure my anticipations in different ways depending on my past experience and so on. These open triangles I've been using to show that there are different ways in which I could experience this tree. The black triangles would be structuring that doesn't seem to be compatible with what happens to my sensory organs. So that in the duck rabbit case, you could structure it as a duck, structure it as a rabbit, but not as a locomotive. So that there are certain things that are eliminated, they're not compatible. So this is just like general philosophy of science. You have a theory which has a lot of structure to it, and it has boundary conditions. and those boundary conditions would be what you get in observation and experiment in the sciences. The boundary conditions here have to do with what happens at your sensory organs. And the problem is, how can Husserl now deal with what happens in the sensory organs when he doesn't want to talk about being an object that impinges upon us and so on? But first, a little more about structuring. There are expectations, and Husserl says that these expectations, he uses a word that in English would be habitualities. You're coming into the habit of experiencing the world in a certain way. And those habitations he calls, in English, sedimentation. In our lives, all the time, things that we are experiencing are sedimenting in us. The sedimentation is a good word because it means that sometimes you're not even aware of it. I talked about the culture, that there is a sedimentation from our life in that culture. And that's why phenomenology is a very fine basis for culture studies. Because in culture studies, one often thinks of culture, that might be literature, art, music, and so on. But anthropologists, they tend to emphasize a lot of other things when they study foreign cultures. They are interested in what Husserl is interested in here, namely all these habitualities that have seeped in and that people are not aware of. You are in your own culture, you're not aware of this. I can give you an example. There was at Stanford in the summer, there was a project, a robot project. They wanted to make very good robots. And they hired in high school students who earned a little summer money by thinking about what had to be programmed into the robot in order to make it behave properly. And lots of things were programmed into the robot. And they made one of the things they made was a robot that could go around in a party and serve wine. You come there with a flat and glasses. And so wine had programmed everything. It could turn wine into the glass and things like that. But what struck people immediately was that the robot went up far too close to the person. Or sometimes they were far too far away. In a culture, there is a suitable distance between people when you're talking to them. And that might differ from one culture to another, but it's the kind of thing you never think about. But when you want to construct a robot, you have to think about all these niederschläge, all these sedimentations. So that they discovered that there's no hope even of extending this so that you get in everything you need. There's no way of predicting that now you got to an end or anything like that. So that's this tremendous richness. And this is a kind of induction from the past, but I think niederschläge or sedimentation is a better word because so much happens. When we talk about induction, we tend often to think about the cognitive process where we go from individuals to the general point. And also it's important, this is not a matter of some things being analytic and others synthetic. When you meet a person, then this person might be a bachelor, but he also has other habits. He smokes or whatever. And then it's not so that his being a bachelor is analytic. That's independent of experience, but the smoking is dependent. So that there is a kind of similarity between Husserl and Quine in that all these things come in as a whole. It's very holistic. And drawing a line and saying this is due to meaning and this is due to facts is simply without any grounding. We can come back to all these things in discussion if you want to. But this also has to do with time, past, present, future, pretension and retention. I talked about this tree that is expected to have been there before. And Heidegger uses actually the same idea in what he calls Ekstasen der Zeitlichkeit, which sounds very fine, but it's simply the same thing as the extension forwards and backwards in time. And I'll give you one example of how new experiences can change our structuring. Husserl says it calls that an explosion of the structuring. There are places in the US where you drive along a highway And then you come to, you see a policeman up there in front, and you check the speedometer and make sure you're driving within the speed limit. Then when you come very close, you see this was really pretty thin for a policeman, just 1 centimeter thick. And then you get, Fussell says, an explosion. You don't any longer see a policeman, you see a picture of a policeman. And that shows how new experience and can, it's not compatible really with what the structure you had, so it is changed. But there are also other things that come in through the habitualities, practical usefulness, values, bodily settings and anticipations. That's a key topic in Merleau-Ponty, but you find it in Husserl also. Actually, you find it in Husserl, we can date it from around 1917. Husserl started seeing how our body plays an important role in our anticipations. And also, it's a zero point in space, body. I'm here. And that's important for the kind of perspective I have. John Perry has done a good deal of it. John Perry and I are colleagues, and we have been teaching these kind of things together on subjectivity and things like that. So those of you who work more in that sort of thing will have a connection between Husserl and Perry here on this point. And I use this iceberg similarly because most of all these anticipations are really below the surface. Most of them, what you notice are these few things that you have thought about and pay attention to, but it's not just that there's a little bit extra, but most of what is important here is below the surface. And here you have Frege's example of the morning star and the evening star. We see the same star, but we have different anticipations, different structure from here and there. And then when the Babylonians discovered that it's the same star, then immediately these two sets of structuring were fused, and we got a lot of anticipations that both dealt with the same star rather than the two different ones. And now we get into what will be the more technical things, which we'll start on tomorrow. We will talk about the notion of an act that you have in Brentano, and both Salmas and Frege's idea of there being, in semantics, the word, the meaning of the word and the object, and Husserl's idea of there being an act, and then something that is a little bit like a meaning, that he calls the noema, and the object. And there are differences, important differences between the notion of sense in Frege and the notion of noema in Husserl, but there is this tripartite structure, which is similar in those two people, and we don't have it in both in Brentano. So that's what we'll start on next time, and we'll get into the more technical terminology, especially that notion of the noema.